Hello, I'm Maruk Said, your microbiology guide. Let's explore in-depth micro techniques and uncover groundbreaking insight together on this educational journey into the fascinating realms of microbes.
Despite having a different cell envelope than other gram-negative bacteria, Treponema pallidum is nonetheless classed as a gram-negative bacterium. Syphilis is a sexually transmitted illness that mostly affects the skin and mucous membranes of the external genitalia, but it can also affect the mouth. This is why you may be familiar with T. pallidum. As an obligatory parasite, Treponema pallidum is a kind of bacterium that cannot exist on its own outside of a live organism. More precisely, outside of an individual's body. They are part of a class of bacteria known as Spirochetes, which are long, thin, and include endoflagella, a band of spiraling protein filaments that give the Spirochetes their spiral form and resemble somewhat less tasty curly fries. By spinning or twisting, the endoflagella aid in the Spirochetes' mobility as well. This action is similar to a drill gradually digging into a piece of wood. There are two methods in which an individual with syphilis might spread the illness to other people. The first method involves Treponema pallidum entering the body through bodily fluids and is referred to as acquired syphilis. Sexual intercourse, including oral, anal, and vaginal sex, as well as microscopic wounds or tears in the skin or mucous membranes of the mouth or external genitalia, can cause that. Additionally, because the lesion is coated in this spirochete-rich fluid, it can occur when people use contaminated needles or come into close contact with an infected person's skin lesion. The second type of syphilis is known as congenital syphilis, and it occurs when a pregnant woman has the disease and Treponema pallidum infects the unborn child either inside the uterus or as it emerges from the vagina. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. The infection in acquired syphilis progresses through three phases. The first stage, known as the early localized stage or primary syphilis, often begins 1 to 3 weeks after T. pallidum attaches itself to the skin or mucous membrane. Syphilitic chancres, or ulcers, develop as a result of the Spirochetes destroying the epidermis and soft tissue wherever they enter the body at this stage. A syphilitic chancre is painless. You may recall this by inserting a U to cause the chancre to cure, as if the discomfort had been cured. These chancres are hard at the base, have elevated edges, and are often coated with a spirochete-rich fluid that can spread to other areas of the body and to other people. The main chancre forms around the external genitalia in people who get syphilis through sexual contact. On the other hand, the main chancre may manifest on the hands or another body part in people who get syphilis by personal contact with a lesion or through some other method. In the meanwhile, some Spirochetes infect nearby lymph nodes and cause lymphadenopathy, or swelling of the lymph nodes. After that, they enter the lymph and finally the bloodstream. Normally, syphilitic chancres resolve on their own within a few months. If transfusion-related syphilis is acquired, there cannot be an early localized stage or primary chancre. The second stage of syphilis is known as the dissemination stage, and it happens 6 to 12 weeks after the initial infection. In this stage, spirochetemia, or the entry of Spirochetes into the bloodstream, results in generalized lymphadenopathy, or the finding of Spirochetes in lymph nodes all over the body. The Spirochetes prefer to attach to and infect endothelial cells in small capillaries close to the skin, which leads to a non-itchy maculopapular rash, small, raised, or flat, that begins on the trunk and moves to the arms and legs, then the palms, soles, genitalia, and other mucous membranes. Sometimes these rashes are papulosquamous, which is when they are extremely scaly and hard, and other times they are pustular, which is filled with the white fluid pus. Furthermore, there may be a condition known as condyloma lata, which is characterized by smooth, white, painless lesions resembling warts that develop on moist places, such as the armpits, genitalia, and the area surrounding the anal region. Because spirochetes are abundant in the lesions that result from these many rashes that can appear anywhere on the body, secondary syphilis is the most contagious stage. Secondary syphilis rashes often go away in a few weeks to months. Latent syphilis is the latent period that follows secondary syphilis. At this point, the illness enters a time of dormancy or lack of symptoms. During this phase, the spirochetes can mostly be found in the tiny capillaries of various body organs and tissues. There are two phases of latent syphilis, an early phase and a late phase. Within a year of infection, early latent syphilis develops. During this period, spirochetes can re-enter the bloodstream, which implies that spirochetes can still be detected circulating in significant quantities in the bloodstream during early latent syphilis, resulting in secondary syphilis symptoms. But because the spirochetes often remain within the microscopic capillaries of different human organs and tissues, the late latent phase usually occurs after a year. It turns out that there are really very few spirochetes in the capillaries of tissues and organs, but when they do, the body mounts a very strong immune reaction that severely damages the cells within, and it sets off the subsequent stage, known as tertiary syphilis. A type IV hypersensitivity reaction is seen in tertiary syphilis, indicating a T-cell-driven immune response that recruits macrophages and other phagocytes and releases pro-inflammatory cytokines such IL-1, Illinois, 6, and tumor necrosis factor. This results in systemic symptoms like a fever, as well as localized signs like redness, warmth, and swelling, or edema. T. pallidum has three main antigens. These comprise the species-specific antigens exclusive to T. pallidum, the group-specific antigens found in all treponemes, and the lipid antigen cardiolipin, which is curiously found in both human cells and spirochetes. Now, by generating antibodies against these antigens, plasma cells prefer to participate in the immunological response. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. In certain circumstances, the immune cells start to huddle together and create a granulomatous lesion called a gumma, and this contains many of various types of immune cells that get surrounded by an outermost layer of fibroblasts. Strangely enough, spirochetes are frequently completely absent from these lesions. Instead, it appears as though the immune cells are overexcited and constricting for no apparent reason. Coagulation necrosis can occur when there is insufficient oxygen in the gumma's central tissue. Several organs are affected by tertiary syphilis. They include the heart and blood arteries, cardiovascular syphilis, the brain and spinal cord, neurosyphilis, the liver, joints, and testes, which do not yet have their own names. In cardiovascular syphilis, there's endarteritis, which is inflammation of the small arterioles called vasa vasorum, which give blood to major arteries like the aorta. As a consequence, the aorta becomes inflamed, or aortitis, and this can lead to the development of aortic aneurysms. In neurosyphilis, the spirochetes take up camp in the capillaries feeding the posterior or rear section of the spinal cord, and this can result in something called tabes dorsalis, which literally translates as wasting or loss of the back of the spinal cord. The protective sheath which covers the nerves running along the back of the spinal cord is damaged, and this results in a loss of vibration sensation and a loss of proprioception, which is the sense of position of the joints and other body parts, like the hands and the feet. That is what happens when syphilis damages the posterior spinal cord. However, occasionally, spirochetes can also invade the capillaries supplying the anterior or front of the spinal cord, causing a condition known as general paresis, which primarily affects the legs and causes loss of sensation, weakness, and sometimes even paralysis. Spirochetes can cause memory loss, changed behavior, slurred speech, difficulties coordinating muscular movements, and even paralysis if they enter the capillaries that supply the brain. A person with syphilis may even experience an Argyle-Robertson pupil, in which the pupil loses its ability to react to light, but retains its ability to constrict when an object is close by, and does nothing in very bright light. Spirochetes can infect an infant with congenital syphilis through the placenta or through the birth canal during labor. During the initial 2 years of the disease, the outcome can vary from a stillbirth or death in the womb to the classic features of a maculopapular rash on the palms and soles of the feet and snuffles, a condition where the nose becomes blocked due to increased secretions containing spirochetes. Infants may also have damage to their liver, spleen, or both, leading to hepatosplenomegaly, as well as eye problems such as optic neuritis. Classic characteristics of late illness, which manifests when the infant reaches 2 years of age, include hearing loss, saddle nose, a bony destruction of the nose, saber shins, a bowed tibia, and Hutchinson teeth, tiny notches in the teeth. Dark field microscopy may be used to detect spirochetes in the chancre fluid, which is the first step in the diagnosis of acquired syphilis. A dark field microscope shines thin slivers of light on a slide so that the background appears dark, while the extremely thin spirochetes light up. You know how we can see dust particles better in a dark room with just a stream of light shining through the door? That's kind of how it is. Serological assays, which search for antibodies against the T. pallidum antigens, are now used to confirm the diagnosis. In addition to tests that identify anticardiolipin antibodies, or REGAN, in the blood, there are non-treponemal assays such as the Venereal Disease Research Laboratory Test, VDRL, and the Rapid Plasma REGIN Test, RPR. The important thing to remember is that they are not exclusive to syphilis. For instance, our bodies may also produce cardiolipin when cells are injured. The treponemal tests come next, which are fluorescent treponemal antibody absorbed, FTA-ABS, and T. pallidum particle agglutination, TPPA. These treponemal assays identify anti-T. pallidum antibodies. As you may expect, the diagnosis of congenital syphilis is a little unusual. When diagnosing congenital syphilis, the mother's and the child's test results are compared. A baby may have congenital syphilis, for instance, if their non-treponemal serologic titer is 4 times higher than their mother's, such as if the infant's RPR is 1:64 and the mother's is 1:16. In general, it's beneficial to get CSF fluid for VDRL, as well as cell counts and protein, for any infant whose mother had insufficient syphilis treatment or who is suspected of having congenital syphilis for another cause. A hearing test, an eye examination, and lengthy bone X-rays are also beneficial. Penicillin is the primary therapy for syphilis, while doxycycline may also be helpful in certain circumstances. However, when taking penicillin, it's crucial to be aware of the possibility of a Jarisch-Herxheimer response, in which spirochetes rupture and release a large number of antigens at once, stimulating the immune system to overreact. When that happens, it results in sudden fevers, sweating, muscle, and joint pains that may last for a few hours up to a few days. Okay, to quickly review. Thus, Treponema pallidum, a spirochete, is the cause of syphilis, a sexually transmitted illness. 3 phases of the illness can result from it. The first is localized primary syphilis, which causes hard chancres. The third type of syphilis is called systemic tertiary syphilis, and it affects several organs. The second type is called disseminated secondary syphilis, and it causes a broad maculopapular rash. Antibiotics like penicillin can be used to treat syphilis, which can be identified by serological testing.